days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are the days of great trial, famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye way of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation come. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he rise, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation Jehovah. There's no God like 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 Jehovah. There's no God like. Behold, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Good morning. I'll be reading Ecclesiastes 2, verses 12 through 24. So I turn to consider wisdom and madness and folly. For what can the one do who comes after the king? Only what has already been done, that I saw that wisdom excels folly as light excels darkness. The wise have eyes in their head, but fools walk in darkness. Yet I perceive that the same fate befalls all of them. Then I said to myself, what happens to the fool will happen to me as to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? I said to myself that this also is vanity, for there is no enduring remembrance of the wise or of fools, seeing that in the days to come all will have been long forgotten. How can the wise die just like fools? So I hated life, because what is done under the sun was grievous to me, for all is vanity and a chasing after wind. I hated all my toil which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to those who come after me. And who knows whether they be wise or foolish, yet they will be masters of all of for which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This is also vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair, concerning all the toil of my labors under the sun. Because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain and their work is a vexation. Even at night their minds do not rest. This is also vanity. There is nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil. This also I saw is from the hand of God. For apart from him who can eat or whom can be have enjoyment. For to the one who pleases him, God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy, but to the sinner, he gives the work of gathering and heaping, only to give to one who pleases God. This also is vanity and a chasing after wind.
Good morning. I want to wish you a blessed Sunday morning. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. So this is a blessed Sunday morning, and it's a blessing to be here on this Sunday morning. It's always a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to be in the church on this Sunday morning. It's always good to be here. And it's good for each person that's able to watch this collectively, because we are the body of Christ united, and we continue to worship together collectively. And now we're trying the new thing of having the videos in terms of they premiere so that they're going to launch right at 10:30 a.m. on the dot, and you're able to watch it together collectively. It even has a chat feature where you're able to correspond and have conversations while the message plays about things. You can write things down and different things and interact with other people if you watch it at 10:30 a.m. when it comes on right at that moment live. Then once it ends, you can replay it at any time or watch it at a later time. But that's a new thing we've been doing the last 2 weeks. It's to encourage more social interaction and social engagement. We're able to correspond together collectively and on YouTube. And so it premieres on YouTube. Once you click the link, you're able to go on there and to interact with other members of the body of Christ. It's just another way to keep us tied together and united as the body of Christ. So that's another good blessing that we have. And I also want to invite you to have your children watch Children's Church and Teenage Church. If you have a child beneath the age of 18, have them watch one of those two messages every Sunday. Children's Church is for those under the age of 12. That's for Children's Church. So if you got a child that's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, they can enjoy those messages. And there's a speaker every week, and they also use clips a lot of times, video clips, because we're in the technological times. And so they use clips and things that they're able to use, where they're able to see different cartoons, hear different songs, and they would see different visual images. And the Children's Church messages aren't long, 10 minutes, 12 minutes, where they're able to get a message. Make sure your children are taking a look at Children's Church, and make sure your teenagers are looking at Teenage Church. Don't view the messages for yourself and not let your children be exposed to the Word of God. The goal of Children's Church is to expose them, give them exposure to the Word of God, and then it builds up an appetite to where they're able to grow in knowledge of the Lord. It also exposes them and teaches them the stories of the Bible, so they'll know who is David, what did he do? They'll know who is Abraham, who is Isaac, who is Jacob, who is Elijah. That way they can get an understanding of who they are, who's Jesus Christ. Because truthfully, on Sunday mornings in service, I don't have time to be able to explain a lot of times the life story of the biblical character. Some of it I take for granted that it's already known and was put in at earlier ages. But this is the time when they rooted and learned those stories. And then when they come to church as adults, or when they're exposed to the Word of God as adults, that foundation can be built upon. That's the goal, it can be built on. It gives something that can be built upon. And so make sure that you make sure your children are exposed to children's church and teenage church. We also have upcoming where we're going to have a Bible study for everybody. Right now they have the Wednesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. I'm going to kick off in August. We're going to have a men's Bible study. And I'm looking at in August a women's Bible study. And we're going to have the senior Bible study as well, where the senior Bible study will launch again. That's going to be at noontime. Wednesdays at 12 noon, where they'll be to interact together collectively and correspond. And I'm also have the Noakes work on the game night. We're going to do something virtually, but have a game night, some sort of game that can be played in terms of a game night virtually. And for the youth ministry, I want them to work on a game night for the young people where they can be connected. That's easy to do with Xboxes and PS4s. That's so easy to do today. And with apps that are on the phone, the games, that's easy to do. You can just involve everybody and interact together. Also, keep in mind our online fitness classes, where we're going to have those take place every Thursday. The women have had two so far. And the men's is on Friday evening. So Thursday at 7:15 p.m. is the women's fitness class, and Fridays at 7:15. This coming Friday, the men's fitness class will be at 7 p.m., so right after prayer. So the goal is come on prayer first. So for the women, Thursday, come on prayer at 6 p.m., then go to the fitness class at 7:15 p.m. on Zoom. And for the men, come on prayer at 6 p.m., but this Friday, the men's fitness class will be at 7 p.m. because I'm starting all-night prayer. And so we'll have all-night prayer starting this Friday at 8 p.m. 8 p.m. Friday, July 31st to 8 p.m. Saturday, August the 1st. And I'm going to kick it off. I'm going to start the first one off at 8 p.m. I'm going to lead that first hour. And then we have different leaders scheduled. The chairman of the deacon board will go next. And then we have different leaders scheduled. We have different deacons, different ministers, different intercessors who are scheduled in terms of leading prayer. And then on the back end, I got where Brother Robinson, you and Sister Trenise Hendricks are going to take that last hour on Saturday. So you may not have known already, but you know now, you're going to take that last hour Saturday, the two of you, and lead prayer. And so we have 24 consecutive hours of prayer. And this is something God laid on my heart. It's laid on my heart that we should go about doing this. And we're going to pray vigilantly as the body of Christ. And there are six focal points in terms of areas we're seeking to pray. That'll be disseminated this week that I had put down. And the purpose of prayer in a scripture to undergird our prayer efforts. And I'm excited about that. Come on and pray. And pray just like you are. The good news is you can have your PJs on. You can have whatever. And you can pray. You can pray laying in the bed. You can pray while you in the living room. You can pray in the kitchen. You can pray wherever you are. You can get on the prayer line. You can be in the car driving and just get on the prayer line. Mute your phone, but get on the prayer line so we don't hear your engine and other things. But get on the prayer line so we can all be praying collectively together. And I'm looking forward to that. There to be a time of great excitement and great joy. Because in the body of Christ, we should have joy. There should be joy. Don't walk around frowned up. Don't walk around sad all the time. Have some joy. And prayer is one of the things that's meant to be joyous. Prayer can be uplifting. We don't always have to pray pitiful. Oh, woe is me. Oh, pitiful wretch I am. Oh, I'm terrible. Oh, I'm no good. God, I'm covered in sin. God, we don't always have to pray from a pathetic mindset. We can pray victorious. God, I'm your son. God, I'm your child. God, you the king, and everything belongs to you, and I belong to you. God, you are great and mighty God. God, you created me in your image, in your likeness. God, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. God, I'm a royal priesthood. God, I'm yours. You can pray with great victory. Don't pray from a pathetic position all the time. Pray from the position of a victor. You can even pray, God, I know it's already done. I'm going to thank you for what you already are doing right now. And so we're looking forward to our intercessory prayer at the end of this month where we're going to have that. and our intercessory prayer. And then we're going to have some announcements and Bible study I'll do pertaining to the month of August. I've given some assignments for Bible study to Reverend Reed and Minister Dale, and Sister Sharon Thomas is coming up and Sister Noakes coming up. I've given some to Deacon Gresham. We have given different people assignments, two of the deacons, two of the ministers, for this coming Wednesday. If you don't know the assignment, go and watch Bible study. I'm not going to announce it now because I'm testing to see, are we watching Bible study? So you won't know what your assignment is unless you've watched last Wednesday's Bible study. So you better break out on YouTube right now and start watching what it is. I gave an assignment that I'm looking for this coming Wednesday to be completed by, that we're going to go through pertaining to Bible study. And continue to remember to support the Haiti effort. Two things. Continue to support the church with tithes and offerings, and continue to support the effort in Haiti for missions that is upcoming. Today I'm going to ask, and we can get right into the text. I'm going to move along. Open back with me to John chapter 4. And we're going to take a look at verses 39 through 42. John chapter 4, verses 39 through 42. And I always read the New Revised Standard Version, the NRSV translation, which is my favorite. And it reads as follows. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." Amen. Lord, we pray you give your vision right now. May you speak through this text right now and minister to the lives of every person that hears this word. I pray, Father God, let this draw each person nearer unto you. And I pray, Father God, that each person gets greater revelation of who you are and their purpose in life right now and is drawn just to deeper levels of discipleship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we've been on this text for the last 3 weeks. I've spent the last 3 weeks on this text in John chapter 4 when we dealt with the woman at the well, and dealing with the woman at the well. And today we're going to go through it, and I'm going to recap a little what we went through, hopefully God willing. I want to start off by looking at the basis for this in terms of that last verse in verse 42. You can underline that, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. But we're going to talk some about finding the meaning for my life, finding the meaning for my life. And last night, this is what came to me in terms of dealing with this. And I'm going to start talking to somebody in life how everything we look at, everything we see on television, just about anything, movies, television, anything we read, a lot of times they have common themes of dealing with a hero, somebody who's heroic. You normally have a hero if he's a male, or a heroine if it's a female. The heroine, where you wanted it to, a hero. And I was just thinking about it in terms of movies. No matter what you like to see, it's always something pertaining to and dealing with a hero. If you look at something like a romantic comedy, if you like romantic movies, doesn't matter what romantic movie is, whatever you like. It can be Love and Basketball, it could be Titanic, whatever you like that's romantic. Somebody's always the hero. There's always somebody who's a hero that you look to, that's looked to in those kind of movies. A lot of times, I've never understood this, but I'm a man, so I don't fully understand it. Like, women will love Lifetime and certain shows like that, and the Hallmark Channel and different things with fairy tale endings, where the man is often Prince Charming, everything, something about him is just perfect. And he's a hero they're looking for. He's a hero. So a lot of times when looking for a mate, they're looking for somebody, where is Prince Charming? Well, I'm going to tell you today, there is no Prince Charming nowhere. No matter how good you think somebody is, everything's not going to be perfect. But there's something that attracts us to the thought of heroic qualities. Even in terms of movies, I can go through things. And growing up, the biggest action stars at the time were people like Arnold Schwarzenegger, Sylvester Stallone. And I loved movies like Commando, Terminator. I watched all the Terminator movies, all the Commando movies, all the Rambos. Even him as an old man playing Rambo, I watched all those. And it was always, he was a hero. They were heroic. Then you got The Rock in different movies, where The Rock a lot of times, he's always the hero. And then even when you get to the Marvel movies, I've seen all of those, where you get to people like, you go through Black Panther, you go to Iron Man, you go to Thor, you go to all those different movies. It's the theme up there as a hero, as a persistent and consistent theme of as a hero. Even in terms of history, sometimes we'll paint a portrait of a person and we only look at certain attributes of them that are heroic. You see those heroic aspects. That's because we are always looking for somebody who comes along to save the day, who comes along to save everything. I even read an article from in dealing with Entertainment Weekly and online and things, and the director, the person who wrote Man of Steel and those Superman movies that have come out recently, where that was even based on his heroic qualities, based on Jesus coming from nowhere, having character that's ideal, having powers that's extraordinary, and being somebody who seen as the S on his chest, coming to save the world, save the day, based on Jesus Christ. Because there's a fascination as a human being with having a savior, somebody who can save and save the day, save everything. And in this text, when we look at verse 42, you see where Jesus is called the savior of the world, the savior of the world. And today we're going to start from that basis. I'm not going to be long. We'll move right along. But you see where he is the savior. And it's professed in verse 42. She says, Jesus is, this man is the savior of the world. And the thing that's always associated with Jesus in the Bible is salvation. That's why we call him Jesus the Christ. Jesus Christus, Jesus the Christ because he's the savior. That's the number one thing we see associated with him is Jesus the Messiah. The Messiah, the Christ just means the Messiah. And the Messiah was the one who would save Israel, the one who would save everybody, the savior of the world. And so Jesus is always seen in the light of salvation. There is no way to deal with salvation without dealing with who Jesus is as the Christ, the one who can save and called to be the savior. And when we deal with salvation, we have to deal with what it is. Salvation is soteria in the Greek. And it's known as the discipline of, if you study, it's known as soteriology. That's why it makes sense. Soteriology is the doctrine of salvation. And salvation just means to deliver, to preserve, to save, to deliver, to preserve, to save. Deliverance is one of the number one words associated with salvation, is the deliverance that's offered by Jesus Christ. And so in terms of being a savior, Jesus is connected with that again and again when you go to the New Testament as the Savior. You don't believe me, go read Luke 2:25. When Simeon saw him, he said he could go in peace. He said, my eyes have seen the Lord's salvation. When he saw Jesus, he saw the salvation of God. He said, I've seen God's salvation. This is the Savior. I've seen the Lord's salvation. And even when you deal with again and again, what's connected him with Paul, with Peter, with James, with John, when you go down the line, salvation is connected with Jesus Christ. And he's seen as the Savior. And one of the important things to note is that when Jesus meets this woman at the well, he's offering her something she doesn't have. 3 weeks ago, I started off talking about how Jesus built up her self-esteem. If you didn't see that, go and watch that message. He built up her self-esteem. She had low self-esteem, a poor self-image, and he built it up and helped her feel better about who she was and what she had done in life. That's one of the great things about interacting with Jesus Christ is you get your self-esteem built up. You don't have to be who you used to be, and you don't have to be judged for your past. Who you are is built up so that you can feel great in Jesus Christ. That you're not what you used to be, and you can be something brand new. That what you were in the past is never held against you because you're a new creation and a new creature in Jesus Christ. So we are never the same when we get in Jesus Christ. We are a whole new being. So what we were and used to be, we don't have to be anymore. You can say, I used to be fearful, but now I can have great boldness and courage. I used to lack knowledge. You can say, now I have knowledge. I'm enlightened in God. I used to not have any power, but now I have authority and power in Jesus Christ. You can say, I used to be running the streets, but now I'm running on behalf of God. You can say, I used to be something negative, but God has called me to be something that's in a positive light. Well, he built up her esteem. The second thing he did, he gave her that sense of significance, where she was significant. She was important to God, and she could feel significant. And it's so important in life, I mentioned last week, to feel significant, to know that you matter. There are signs up all over the place to know that Black Lives Matter. And the underlying message behind that is to know that no matter what the world says about me, my life matters. That no matter how the world can try to judge me, condemn me, I matter. It's important to know that you matter. And you got to know as a believer in Christ that you matter to God. And so it's so important to know that when everybody's putting you down, when everybody's telling you the negatives about yourself, it's so important to know that you matter. You got to tell yourself right now, I'm significant and I matter. And today, the third dimension that I want to hit on, he gave her that sense of self, but then he offered her the greatest gift of all. The third thing he gave her was the gift of salvation. The gift of salvation. The gift of salvation. And one of the first points I'm going to hit on today, I'll probably only get to this one, one of the first points I'm going to hit on is how when we deal with Jesus Christ and the power of Jesus Christ, you got the power of Jesus Christ unleashed in your life. When you operate under the power of Jesus Christ, then you're able to receive and to be saved from a meaningless existence and a life that seems like it has no purpose. You saved from a meaningless existence and a life that seems like it doesn't have purpose. That's one of the main things Jesus does is give meaning to us and to our existence in a society that seems meaningless. He gives meaning to a meaning life that seems meaningless. You know how I know everybody's looking for meaning, whether they know it or not? Because all you got to do is watch what are the things people read. Why do people read so much and so many different books dealing with trying to find purpose, trying to find meaning? They'll look everywhere and anywhere to get it. They'll go to Steve Harvey. They'll go to Oprah Winfrey. They'll go to Van Zandt. They'll go to Tony Robbins. They'll go to anybody, the Dalai Lama. They go anywhere to try to find meaning. That's what makes Farrakhan so attractive to some people. He preaches a lot of hate speech, and I don't endorse Farrakhan because I can never endorse hate. But the reason people run to him is because he gives some sense of meaning to the existence of Black people. It's the wrong way. I don't agree with his path, and I'll never agree with hate. I'll never agree with preaching hate, and I'll never agree with condemning people and tearing people down. That's never a positive thing. But everybody's looking for meaning and trying to find some sense of meaning for their lives. Because you'll go through life without meaning. And what Jesus gives, that salvation, he saves from that meaningless existence. And if we add on to that, you can get this down. What he brings about is that Jesus saves us from death. From death. Jesus saves us from death. I'm saved from death in Jesus Christ. And death is deeper than what you think it is. To understand what death is, you got to know both dimensions. Death is in a physical sense. There's a physical death, and there's a spiritual death that can occur. Death in the Greek refers to both of them. And the Greek word for death is thanatos. Thanatos. Thanatos, which is why it makes sense if you saw those in those Marvel movies. They were called the character who brought death, Thanos, is from Greek, thanatos, known as death. It's the image of what death is. When you're reading the Bible in Revelation, when it says death came, it's thanatos came. Thanatos, death. Death. And it says he rode on one horse and brought hell with him. Death. And death is about, the definition of death isn't what we think. When you deal with thanatos, what death is, death is separation from the salvation of God. That's what death is. It's separation from the salvation of God. Death is separation from life with God. That's what it means to be dead. Is you separated from the life of God. You separated from the salvation of God. It's to be separated from God. That's why you can be physically alive right now and still be dead, because you can, your body might be living. But if you spiritually separate from God, you did already, to where you're not connected to him. And so you go through life dead. And what's terrible is if you go through this life dead, life does not have joy. Life has no meaning. And sometimes what you got to do is sit back and evaluate your own life and say, do I have the life in me that God has brought to me? Or am I dead, the walking dead already? That's what sometimes frustrates me about church sometimes on Sundays. Sometimes people come to church and they already dead. They drag in, they come in. It's like they just come in just to say, well, the only reason I'm here is just to make sure I get into heaven. It's not I'm coming to worship. It's not I'm coming with joy. It's not I'm coming with praise. It's not I'm coming with excitement. It's that they just come in out of tradition. And that's not what pleases God. What pleases God is when you're able to find meaning for your life. And when you find meaning for your life, you're going to have some joy somewhere. That's why if you're sad right now, you got to find meaning for your life so that you can have some joy somewhere that wells up on the inside. When you got joy, it doesn't matter what's happening to you. You can still have some happiness somewhere. You can have joy in the midst of the coronavirus crisis. You can have joy in the midst of being stressed out on every end. You can have joy even when you're stressed out. You can still have some joy. You can have joy when everything in your life is going wrong. You can still find some joy somewhere if you find that meaning in Christ. And that's why it's critical. It's critical today to find your purpose. You got to find your purpose. You got to find the meaning for your existence. Because if you don't know your purpose, we look for other things to bring meaning. And what we do is look for things that bring meaning that disappoint us. I can talk. Sometimes people get their meaning from other people, from a relationship. Well, I get my meaning, my purpose from this relationship. And then when the other person dies, they lose meaning. That's what happens sometimes in marriages sometimes. When one dies and they've been together a long time, the other one dies right after because they feel like I've lost part of my purpose. I've lost my purpose, my meaning. I've lost how I defined myself and who I am, and it's gone, who I am. And it's always dangerous, I say, when you define yourself by anybody or anything. That's why even in America, I always say we are what we do, when the truth is what we do is not who we are. So if somebody says, people don't say, respond to things a certain way. If you say, what do you do for a living? A person doesn't answer, I do for a living. They say, I am. Because they've associated themselves with what they do. That's why if a person has a low-level job, it can be hard on them. Because sometimes they build their esteem in what they do, and they think if I do a low-level job, then I'm a low-level person. And you got to disconnect sometimes what you do from who you are. What I do is not who I am. Else, if you connect it, when they take your job from you, they take the essence of who you are from you. They take your identity from you. That's why when some people lose a job, they get laid off. They get fired after a number of years. It's like mourning the loss of a person because they identified who they were by what they did. They look for meaning. It's even dangerous for a parent to get the meaning for their life from the children because they'll hold them hostage. They won't let the child grow up. If a parent gets their full meaning from saying, my job is to nurture and raise my children. Once the child is 18, 19, they won't let them go. They'll be blowing that child's phone up day and night, and the child will be sending them to voicemail. They'll be blowing that child's phone up when they're 23, 24, 25. The child will be married, and they'll still be calling day after day, trying to keep the hooks in them, and the child will be trying to pull away because they can't get their full identity from that. It's dangerous sometimes you keep a child from growing. That's why the most successful parents nurture a child, develop a child, pour into the child, help the child to become. And then when you place it in them, the child will come back at some age. When you 18, 19, 20, you just want to be free. It takes a while, but then when you hit the rough waters of life, you start getting about 30, you start coming back and trying to get things that were missing in terms of childhood. Meaning can't come from any of those things. You can't even get meaning from your position because they can take it from you. Well, my meaning comes from Reverend so-and-so. I'm Pastor so-and-so. Well, they'll lock you out the church, and then you've lost your meaning. Deacon so-and-so, they'll put you off the board. You've lost your meaning. You've lost your meaning. Meaning can't come from none of those things. This is going to help young people if you're looking for meaning. Anybody out here you looking for, what's my purpose? You don't find it in all those different things. In order to find meaning for your life, you got to find Jesus Christ. I wish somebody had told me when to college in order to find my major, talk to God. I wish somebody had told me in order to find my career, talk to God. I heard certain things, but I didn't listen. Sometimes people can say something to you, but you don't hear it. And so somebody can tell you something, but you don't hear it in here. You hear it here, but you don't hear it here. And that's what I'm saying. I wish sometimes I listened more. There are certain things I would have known earlier in life, but I wasn't in position to be able to hear. And so today, what I want us to get is that if we want to find meaning for our lives, we want to find joy, it's too many unhappy Christians. It's too many Christians without any joy in life. It's too many Christians who are dissatisfied with their marriages. It's too many Christians who are dissatisfied with their careers. It's too many Christians who don't have joy. And in order to get that, you got to get what Jesus was talking about to this woman, where he said, I got living water that you don't know about. He said, you got some water in that well, but that's stale water. He had to let her know, I got some living water. And if you come to me, you get life. And one of the amazing things is that when you seek after God, when you start reading his word, when you start praying, when you start putting God first, you're going to see that you're going to get life and be animated. You're going to be brought back to where you're supposed to be. You're going to get brought back to where you should be when you seek after God. And so if I want to find meaning for my existence, if I want to find that salvation that Christ offers, what I have to do then is come to the source and get that living water that he offers, that living water. At living water. With Jesus, the number one thing connected to him, I mentioned, is salvation. But one of the top things on that list right after that is life. That's why when you read John, it says, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. Life is always connected with Jesus. I've come that you might have life and have it abundantly. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Life is always connected with Christ. And I've learned this, the closer you get to Christ, the more you grow in your love for humanity. You can't get close to God without loving people more. And what's going to happen is the more you love God, the more he changes your character, the more you become like him, the more doors start to open in your life. A lot of doors close because we're not close enough to God. The closer we get to God, the more doors open because the more we resemble Christ. And the more we resemble Christ, the more our character is like him. And then we're going to attract even more people around us. The people that's supposed to be in our lives are going to start to come and be made manifest. The doors and opportunities that's supposed to open will be made manifest. The opportunities of employment that's supposed to be for us to be elevated, they open because we open to the things of God. And today, to help us if you want to find your purpose, be more open to the things of God. Stop changing and stop sticking to the old confessions you got. When the first thing you do when somebody asks you to do something is curl your lips up to say no, something's wrong somewhere. When the first thing you do is you hesitant to the things of God, you hesitant and you resist the opportunities God is opening up for you, you always have trouble being able to find joy in life. You always have difficulty with that. What you got to do is be open to those opportunities. And you think I'm preaching to you, but I'm preaching to myself because that was hard for me for a number of years. My natural reaction was to say no to any opportunities God opened. And what God had to do is put me on the table and put me in surgery and work on me to where he transformed my heart. He transformed my mind to where I could embrace those things. We all are works in progress. None of us are perfect. But what he does is transform us into his image and likeness. And now my first response is more yes than no. At one time, my first response would be more condemning, and he made it into more affirmational. He changed it from one way perspective to another perspective. When I used to look at what can't be done, once you catch Jesus' mindset, you start saying it can be done. You start seeing what is possible for your life. And then you start to realize it's never too late to be able to walk in the will of God. You can be 60 years old and still embrace the will of God. You can be 70 and embrace the will of God. You can have dropped out of school and you can still go back and complete your education. You can be burned for many years and God can still make a way to where you're able to have children. You can have given up on finding love and God can still open the door to where you find the love that you're looking for. It's never too late with God. And you got to know, just like this woman did, she saw the Savior. She said, I've found the Savior of the world, the Savior. And when you get in Jesus Christ, you will be saved from whatever is seeking to destroy you. You saved from whatever is seeking to take you off course. You even saved from going through this life dead. And all you got to do is make a decision. If you're a person say, I don't express myself emotionally, all you got to do is make a decision to wake up. You got to start speaking to the inside and tell yourself, feelings, wake up again. Heart, wake up again in Jesus' name. Come back to life. Heart, open up again and make me generous again in Jesus' name. I need to be more generous. I need to be more giving. I need to be more loving. All you got to do is speak it into existence, and it can take place. You got to believe in the power that you have to speak things into existence. And there's some stuff you can dismiss and send away. You can tell negative mindsets, I rebuke you, go away. You can send away sarcasm. I'll no longer be sarcastic. I'll no longer be negative all the time. I'll no longer be tearing down people. I'll no longer be jealous. I'll no longer be envious. I'll no longer hurt people. I'm going to be a new creature because I've met the Savior of the world. Jesus can even save you from yourself and your own self-sabotaging behaviors. That's the amazing thing. He will save us from ourselves. He'll save me from myself. And the truth is, we all need to be saved from ourselves. We all need to be saved because there's some good in us and there's some other stuff in us. I call it other. I don't want to say it's evil. Other. There's some other. But Paul said, the good I would do, I don't do. He said, the evil I don't want to do, that I do. There's some good and some bad. I can talk. Some of the good can be, oh, I'm going to spearhead this effort. I'm going to help people. I'm going to go out and collect. I'm going to go and be a blessing to somebody. I'm going to go affirm somebody. I'm going to go uplift somebody. I'm going to encourage somebody to go to school. I'm going to encourage somebody. They can make it economically. I'm going to give them some money to help them out so that they all right. I'm going to help watch their children. I'm going to help them with their mortgage. I'm going to help make sure this taken care of. That's the good that we do. The bad sometimes is done is when we do those things, let us find out the person said something about us. Or let us find out the person stabbed us in the back. Let us find something like that out. And then we start plotting against them. We start working against them. Then we start thinking evil thoughts. Then we start tearing down the good that was done. we start tearing down and do the opposite. Sometimes we even start sabotaging people. We don't tell the truth, but sometimes we do. We'll let somebody go on an endeavor knowing they're going to fail, and we'll send them out there and watch them fail so that we think, now they know they needed me. Now they can see. We do that sometimes. That's the evil that has to be put down. It has to be destroyed. One of the amazing things in Jesus Christ, and this is a hard concept to grasp, but in Jesus Christ, when we embrace the fullness of his power and who he is, we have dominion over sin, which means it is technically, it's theoretically, and it's realistically possible to rule over sin and to lead a life that's sinless. It is possible. Humanly, we say, no, I'm going to keep sinning, but honestly, it's possible, which means there should be some times you go through without sin. There should be times you say, you don't have to say every day I'm giving in to sin. Every day my thoughts got to be this way. Every day. You're going to have attacks. The enemy going to attack you, but it shouldn't be all the time. It shouldn't be all the time. We get more and more like Christ. Maybe we won't be 100% Jesus, but how you know you can't be 99.999%? How you know you can't get to 98, 97? Sometimes we just satisfied with that 1% being like Christ and saying, I look just like Jesus in this pinky toe down here. When God is saying, I'm waiting for the whole thing to look just like Jesus. And so we got to be open more to transformation, to God's power to transform our existence. So he saves us from ourselves. Because honestly, the evil we want to do leads to eternal damnation, to destroy us. Because that's one of the things. Everything you do is sowing a seed. And I had to see it before I could understand. I had to see it here. That everything you do is sowing a seed. So every time you help somebody, when you reach your hand out physically, you're reaching your hand out in the spiritual realm, you're sowing a seed of blessing that has to come back in your own life. Every time you make a confession that's positive to somebody and you tell them, I see the greatness in you, you're speaking something into existence that's going to come back in your own life and be amplified, the greatness comes back to you. That's why you got to be a blessing to somebody. That's why you got to be a help to somebody. That's why you have to do good to somebody else, because you're sowing seeds that's going to be made manifest in your life and the lives of your children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren that are to come, that's multiplied back. Which is why you can't repay evil for evil. Because if you do evil, you're sowing seeds too. And that evil is going to grow up and come back as well. And so one of the things I want us to get today is how in Jesus Christ we get salvation from that meaninglessness of our existence. And he has a purpose and a meaning for our life. On the job, they will keep you in a position. They won't promote you. On the job, they'll use you to make them look good. On the job, they'll take your best ideas, your best thoughts, the best strategies, and use them as their own. On the job, they'll look for a way to put you out and to get you out your position. On the job, they will send you out there during the coronavirus to die just so they're able to meet budgetary goals and able to have the money flow in. On the job, they are not going to care about you. Don't expect it. But you got to know that God cares and that you are significant to him and you got meaning in him. You got to know that even when they try to box you in and keep you in a position, God will open the door on the other side to where you're able to rise. And you got to realize that even when they try to put you in prison and lock you away, God has made a way of escape. Where you're able to get out the jail they lock you in and you're able to rise up and become. When they took Joseph and they put him in the pit and put him in prison, they didn't realize that God had opened a stairway where he'd be able to come up and rise and get into the palace. That sometimes when people are trying to tear you down and destroy the essence of who you are, all they're doing is setting you up so you're able to rise and go to another level. That's why you got to repay evil with good. That's why you got to repay curses with blessings. That's why you got to do good for somebody. Even when they don't do good by you, you got to do it because you serve the living God. And you got to be a blessing to somebody because your life has meaning. You got to know I am significant. I do have meaning, and there's a purpose for my life and my existence. God saved you for a reason. You're not just saved out of coincidence. You saved for a purpose, and you saved for a reason. Tell yourself, you got to tell yourself at home, I'm saved for a reason. I'm saved for a purpose. I'm going to come to a close. Saved for a reason. Saved for a purpose. And what we ultimately get and the salvation that we get. One Sunday, it's upcoming. I'm hit on all the different callings we have. I'm going to go each week through one calling. But you saved. You saved. And there's a universal salvation that God gives to everybody who professes faith in him. A universal salvation. Go back to John 3:17. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world. God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. The dimension of salvation that we get is known as soul safety. S-O-U-L, safety, soul safety. We get soul safety in God. Your soul is saved. The physical body will die. Every human being is going to experience that. The physical body will die. But you get soul safety. Your soul is saved. Your soul. And the soul is very complex. The soul in Greek is spelled P-S-Y-C-H-E. We say psyche, but psyche. Psychology, that's the base of psychology. That's the base of psychology. And the root of when you deal with the soul. The soul is the life. The soul is the breath of life. The soul is the vitality. The soul is deals with that which animates. The soul is going to deal with the inner man, the inward thoughts. Nobody can see your soul. People can see your face. So they'll look at your face and they can tell if your face is made up nicely. You got that nice MAC makeup. Do you got your Sephora on? Do you have your Ulta Beauty? Do you have your Mary Kay? Do you have the right makeup? They'll look at that, but nobody will be able to see that the soul is black on the inside, that the soul is not pure, that the soul is not made up. The soul is what's hidden. The physical can be smiling, and the soul can be saying, I don't even want to be here right now. I'm putting on this fake plastic smile so I can pretend. I'll pretend that I'm happy when I'm not happy. The soul, the inward thoughts, it's the passions, it's the desires. It's the seat. It's where you sit when you deal with the soul. And the soul, it deals with the part God's going to look at. That's why I go through the Bible. Soul is so important. Read Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. Verse 4 says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. When you go to verse 5, it says, Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and then all your might. Love God with all your soul. Over there in Matthew, I believe it's around Matthew 10, Jesus tells the disciples, don't be afraid of the one who can destroy the body. He tells them, don't worry about Satan. Don't worry about Satan. Don't worry about demons. Don't worry about enemies. They're going to try to ravage the body. He said, don't worry about them. He said, you worry about the one who's able to destroy both the body and the soul. That's God. God is the one who has control of the soul. If I don't give my soul to him, then Satan gets it, the soul. The soul is so important. And it's the safety of our souls. He offers that salvation where he saves souls. That's why we'll say, he saved my soul. He saved my soul. In American vernacular, we'll call the soul the will, the mind, and the emotions. That's the soul. The soul will comprise all those things when we deal with the soul. It's the essence of who we are when you deal with the soul. And salvation is ultimately, I'm going to close, about soul safety. God saving our souls. That's why you give your life to Christ. It's because he can save your soul so you don't have to experience death. I mentioned there were two types of death. Everybody's going to die physically. This body is going to go in the ground. I work out a lot. I spend a lot of time trying to eat healthy, taking care of my body. And I try to keep it up best I can. But I always know that one day this body goes in the ground. I know that. This body, I won't take it with me. You will not take your body with you. This physical body goes down. But the soul, the essence of who I am, keeps living. And it'll never die. And so in truth, the Christian never dies because the body is not who I am. A Christian never dies because your soul lives forever. And in Revelation verse chapter 2, verse number 11, we're able to escape what's known as the second death. And the key of salvation that Christ offers is you don't have to worry about the second death. The second death is when you lay this physical body in the ground. That's the first one. But the second one is when your soul, when your spirit, when it leaves and it goes in, up to God, that it doesn't have to make its abode in hell. And that's why David and the old saints could be so excited about the coming of Jesus, that even though they didn't get to see him, he could say in Psalm 16, verse 10, I know you won't let my soul rest in hell. And one of the things we get in Jesus Christ is to know that our souls get to go and be with God. That's why you don't have to preach hell to people. You don't have to tell people about hell, because all hell does is try to scare people. You don't got to let people know I'm worried about you going to hell. What you got to do is tell them about the goodness of God and let them know how great God has been in your own life and how good he's been to you. And if you let them know about the goodness of God and who he is, and let them know that he made a place in heaven that's designed just for you. He made room in heaven just for you. And God wants to spend all of eternity showing you his blessings. And God wants all to be saved. He don't just want me to go to heaven. He wants everybody to be in heaven and enjoy him forever. And you got to let them know, don't fear death and don't fear what the enemy can do to you. Don't fear that one day I'm going to die. What's going to happen? You got to know that you spend eternity with Jesus Christ. And you got to know that you're going to bask in his glory. You're going to bask in his goodness. And this woman who didn't deserve salvation, because if I tell the truth, none of us deserve to be saved. None of us deserve to go to heaven. But because God is so good, we're able to experience the goodness of God and the grace of God of who he is. And he makes a place for each of us. And so you got to know my life has great meaning. You got to know there's great meaning to my life. You're not just isolated. Don't let the enemy beat you up during the coronavirus and make you think you're all alone. No, you're not. You're not by yourself. There are angels there with you, and your life has meaning. You don't give up. You don't lay down. You don't die right now because your life has meaning, and it's too significant to be lost right now. That's why even if you get sick, sometimes you got to tell your body, I shall recover. And I'm going to get back up again. Even when you feel tired, you got to tell yourself sometimes, I got to get up, keep going, because my life is so valuable. And it's got so much meaning. There are others who are waiting on me to be a help and to pour out into their lives. And you got to know you're a valuable soldier in God's army. You're not a private. You're not a corporal. You're not even a sergeant. You got to tell yourself, I'm a general in God's army. I'm valuable in God's army. God needs me. The Lord has need of me. Even the disciples were sent to go get a donkey. I'm going to close. And he said, all you got to do, he was looking for a place. He had to ride in the city, Palm Sunday. He said, just tell him the Lord has need of me. And you got to get up every day knowing God has need of me. That's what keeps you going. God needs me. Because sometimes people will make you feel like you're unwanted. People will make you feel you're unwanted in your own home, in your own family. They'll make you feel, we don't need you. We can go on without you. And it'll hurt you at the core. It'll bruise you. It'll destroy you. In relationships, people will make you feel like we don't need you. And if you get your esteem from that, it will crush you. It's going to hurt, but it shouldn't crush you. People can hurt you, but they shouldn't be able to just crush you and make you give up. And so it's going to hurt, but you got to go over to the side and talk to God and know that God has need of me. God needs me. God needs me, he needs me, and he needs me. And that's what I was talking to about in pastoral care on Tuesday. I was saying there is one place you got to know you always need it and you're always valuable, in God's family. You can get put out of 7-Eleven for coming with no shirt, no shoes, no service. You'll get put out of some stores now if you don't wear a mask, because it's mandatory to wear a mask. You can't go in. There's some places that won't treat you and won't help you where you can get put out of. But there is a place that God has down here on the earth that no matter what you come like, you can still come in. You can come in and be high and you can still come into God's house. You can come in and be drunk and you can still come into God's house. You come in with no clothes, not have a shirt, have nothing, and come into God's house. You can come in with nothing in your pocket, not have a dollar, and still come in to God's house. And there is no loitering sign. There is no sign that there is no room in God's house. There's always a place in the house of God. You are able to come just like you are, at your best and at your worst. There's room in God's house because you matter and are significant and you got meaning to God. You got such meaning to God, God will abandon and leave all those he's already got saved to come and get you and bring you back into the fold. He'll go after you. We say he'll leave the 99 and come after one. God will leave the millions to go and get one. He'll leave the billions to go get one and bring them back to the other billion. He'll leave you that important to him that he'll leave those who are already saved and sanctified. He know they covered. I got them covered. I got to go get the one that's uncovered and bring them into the fold. Hear this today. Your life has meaning. Your life has meaning. It has direction. It has direction. If you don't know the meaning, you can't find the meaning for it. I always tell you the best way to do it is do an intensive. I'm going to close with that. Do an intensive. When you at the end of college, I remember at the end of college, the last semester, to be on track to graduate, because I played around for a long time, undergraduate years, I played around. I took it wasn't even supposed to be legal to do it, but I did it anyway. I used every route I could, correspondence courses, internet courses, and went to class in person. I took 36 hours that last semester when I wasn't supposed to take them. I got force overrides, everything. So we had to graduate on time. I took intensives. I'd sit in some classes 8-9 hours a day to get through weekends, Saturdays too. Not Sunday, but Saturdays. They didn't offer Sunday. I also would have been in there too, out to make sure to get out of school. It was intense because I wanted to graduate. I wanted to be done. And to graduate, it's intensive. It's an intensive. You push through. There are times when I was out of shape, I wanted to get in shape. And some people say, do 3 days a week, do such and such. And I would look online. I Googled everything. I went to a million websites, bodybuilding.com, musclewomenfitness.com, a million sites. And I said, if I do 6 days a week, this is intense. But if I do 6 days a week, I'm going to get in shape faster by pressing in. I'm going to press in further. I'm going to press in deeper educationally, but I'm going to press in deeper physically. That if I press in, I'm going to get the results I want. If I need to know my purpose, if I need to know the meaning for my life, if I need to know the existence of my life, I can't do what everybody else does and read the Bible a couple of times in every few months. I can't do that. I got to press in, and I got to every day sit down and just read and read and read and sit before God and sit there quietly and just talk to God and say, tell me my purpose. Tell me my purpose. Tell me my purpose. I got to be intense about it. I got to go after it. I got to do it intensive. When I'm riding in the car, tell me my purpose. When I'm walking, tell me my purpose. When I'm going to the store, tell me my purpose. I got to keep talking to God until he tells me my purpose. You got to hang on to God and do what Jacob did and say, I won't let you go until you tell me. Jacob said, I won't let you go till you bless me. You got to say, I won't let you go till you tell me my purpose. And until you tell me my purpose for living, I'm going to stay after you. And you got to tell me the meaning for my life. And if you want results nobody else gets with God, you got to do what nobody else will do. Spend time with God. If you want the same relationship everybody else got with God, do the same thing. Don't give them no time. But if you want a deep relationship with God, if you want to know your purpose, if you don't want to just meander through life, you got to spend time with God nobody else will, so he can tell you your purpose, so that he can tell you, so you can hear him say it. You got to do that. And I guarantee you, when you do that, you'll hear from God. I guarantee you, when you're intensive about it, you'll hear from him. And you don't got to believe me. Believe the scriptures. I believe it's Matthew 7:7. Ask, and you shall find. Knock, and it says ask. And it talks about seeking, and it talks about knocking. It says ask, and it will be given. Ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and you shall find. And I want to stay with the King James. And knock, and the door shall be opened. NRSV has it a little different, but it talks about asking, seeking, and knocking. Ask God, and it says it shall be given. Seek, and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Ask, seek, and knock. And the amazing thing is when you put them all together, ASK comes back to ask. Ask, seek, and knock makes the acronym of ASK. Ask God to find that meaning. And then you enjoy the salvation. The salvation. The fullness of the salvation. Next week, we're going to get deeper into calling and deal with more about salvation. But that's the first dimension of salvation that he brought in terms of that salvation. So I wanted to make sure we got that today. Keep reading this scripture for next week. And we're going to pick up talking about how Jesus Christ is our salvation. Our salvation. Even on the coronavirus crisis, he's our salvation. And this crisis, you got to remember this. This is a good time to be still. This has been an excellent opportunity to improve so many areas of life. Excellent opportunity to get closer to God. You got time to read and pray. Nothing's open late. Nothing. You can't go many places. You can read and pray. This is an excellent opportunity to get closer in terms of relationships, repair broken relationships in the home. This is an excellent opportunity for you to get your financial life in order, not to go out to eat all the time, not to be ordering DoorDash, Uber Eats day after day, but to conserve your money and to be eating in the home. It's an excellent time to take care of the physical temple. There's no excuse not to go walk some around the house, around the neighborhood you can walk. It's an excellent time to bring balance, even emotionally, because you got to be still. So those of you that's worry warts, those of you that's anxious, you talk real fast, you're anxious all the time, this is a time to be still and know that he is God. It's an excellent opportunity for that to take place right now. I wish you a blessed Sunday morning, and I'm going to just say be blessed. Now unto him who is fully able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his glorious presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise, immutable, true God our Savior, be glory and majesty, both dominion and power, now and forever. Amen. Be blessed this Sunday morning. God bless you.